A big hello to everyone. The analytical club is coming back
YouTube.
after
И вживую тоже.
Months of absence. YouTube live session. Someone, yes, we're coming back. Yes, good evening, everyone. Once again, it's a pleasure to be back online.
Действительно, наверное,
everyone
тема...
is up and running. The topic for today's discussion has been up in the air for quite a while.
Мы видим, что
on the one hand side,
протесты...
we see that over the past several months, the protests are, if they are transforming, they're not ending.
Говорят про диалог, про его необходимость, но...
On one hand side, everybody keeps talking about the dialogue, it's necessary to engage in a dialogue, but everybody has a different understanding what that dialogue is, or would be, or should be, how it should be built, maintained. So right now, I would like to talk about the dynamics and the potential future, what the future might hold. We don't really have historic parallels or historic comparison from retrospect.
Диалоги,
we've seen some protests in other countries, protests that led to some form of a dialogue. In Poland, way back in the day, and Armenia, quite recently, very recently, Ukraine, several rounds of protests, followed by discussions, dialogues. So yes, those situations are different, but then again, it would be interesting to consider the external experiences of neighboring countries, not the neighboring countries, about, as to how these crises were overcome. Chatham House rules apply not just to the speakers, not to the moderators, but also to the those wishing to ask a question. If you want to drop something sensitive, something that's not supposed to be available to other participants, we'll simply make sure there will be recording.
Приветствую всех участников нашего заседания экспертов.
Валерия, the floor is yours. Yes, I would like to welcome.
Повестку мы уже сказали. Я мое.
Expert analytical experts and analyst club. You've heard the agenda. And
я бы хотела только обратить внимание. Все говорят о
All that's left to me is basically give the floor to the remaining speakers. So indeed, everybody keeps talking about the dialogue. However, in Belarus, at least all the Belarusian parties,
Лукашенко требует убраться.
Лукашенко demands the people to leave the streets to engage or to initiate the dialogue. And the opposition kind of makes it a condition. Makes it a prerequisite to release, to first release the political prisoners and the violence and punish those.
Несмотря на то, что о диалоге говорят.
Perpetrators of violence. However, indeed, all the parties keep talking about the dialogue, but the readiness, the preparedness to that is quite low. Sound interruption. Ewa Zakowska. Please disable your microphones.
Всем принудительно выключите, если у тебя есть такая кнопочка.
Сейчас я ее включу.
Please make sure you mute your microphones unless you're the one doing the talking at the moment. Right, Andrey Kazakevich, has he joined us? Yes, I'm here. I'm right here. Okay, great.
Нет, да, у нас все спикеры есть, только,
right.
Возможно, позже к нам
online,
включится в статусе советника Светлана Тихановского.
Прошу
тебя за этим следить, потому что мне с телефона не видно, кто из участников.
Please, Anton, make sure you follow that, because I'm off my phone. I cannot really see that.
Plan
is in Warsaw, so it's quite difficult for her to join the discussion. However, Svetlana's advisor is in Warsaw, so he might join us, but the probability of that is unclear. Please keep me apprised. Okay, please, let's get back to Dmitry. Громаков. Yes, thank you very much indeed. Good afternoon, good evening, rather, everyone. Thank you for this invitation. I appreciate it. Ukraine has become one of the triggers of what's happening in Belarus. And I believe the main spanking boy. Spanking. That's not that precious in terms of friendship. So a country that can be lost as a friend, but somehow separated. Well, indeed, Ukraine does have a rich experience, vast experience of dialogue. It's not clear to me why everybody is so preoccupied with 2014, but nobody goes as far back as 2004, when the Orange Revolution happened, and the dialogue happened through intermediaries, through intermediaries, mediators. And essentially, in 2004, we were able to avoid conflict scenarios. There were no tough, violent detentions, so people be thrown to prison. We did not have a radical turn of events as 2014 has witnessed. I believe that the scope of conversation, the scope for dialogue is open. The question is in Belarus. The question is who that dialogue is to be held with. I mean, we understand that Lukashenko does not wish or cannot engage in a dialogue to those who want to take his part. Plus, what Valeria has said, it's the provisions for this dialogue. The prerequisites set forth by the opposition are unacceptable for the government, for the powers that be, because it would be unclear what the essence of the dialogue is going to look like. So this there's a bit of a struggle going on. And essentially, not a single party at this point is seeking that dialogue.
Улица, собственно говоря.
The third entity or the third party to this dialogue is the street. Who's controlling the street these days? People in the streets. And when many people say that the street is not controlled by anybody, and is not controlled by neither the opposition nor the, nor the Russian party, or the Russian side, or the Western side, or Lukashenko,
well,
in that case, it's clear where the fear on the part of the government comes from. Why the government is so afraid to engage in any sort of dialogue. And it's also clear the grounds of mistrust, lack of trust in any of the dialogue, where it's coming from. So the key issue of the Belarusian dialogue today is the issue of trust, or lack thereof, across all the parties to the potential dialogue. The search for the compromise is only possible in two options, or two scenarios. Scenario one, everybody should recognize the rights or the jurisdiction of every side, every party to the dialogue. That president should be recognized, his power to engage in the dialogue in some capacity. So from the side of the bureaucrats, bureaucracy, some people that voted for him indeed. Also, Babarika, Tikhanovskaya, other opposition leaders who might be in prison, they should be recognized, or their political weight should be recognized. They should be recognized and regarded as parties to the dialogue with the political system of Belarus. And the third party is still going to be the street, the people out in the streets. In this case, it's very important to not be fooled by who is taking to the streets and who is controlling the streets, because this is always the grounds and the possibility, the reason for manipulation. The possibility of third parties or third countries, if these exist in this process, you know, they can try to manipulate this dialogue or to try to become parties to it indirectly. Let's put it this way, without mediation, without intermediaries, it would be very difficult to arrange this sort of a dialogue. So, in my opinion, Belarus must determine some intermediaries and some negotiators. Plus, Belarus needs to build the negotiation platform. Back in the day, in 2004, I made a reference to that. Was an ex-president of Poland came, Leonid Kuchma was around, and Angela Merkel represented Germany, I guess. So they acted as negotiators. And then everybody accepted the position that peace and agreement among the society is more important than political ambitions. Is this sort of reconciliation possible in Belarus to resolve the crisis? That's an open question. As we see it, Lukashenko does not intend to give in, if he does not intend to release the power. So saying that, or talking today, that the elections today are an opportunity or an option, presidential elections, I mean, it's not really possible. So and other tools should be searched, should be sought. For example, the electoral process on the parliamentary elections should be launched. That will, again, help every party of the process take shape and gain weight, that weight to be recognized, and some logic will be acknowledged, because this process is based on confrontation. It cannot end in a non-conflictory manner. This is how it goes. Any questions there? Not so far. We will allow ground, allow the floor for questions at a bit of a later stage.
Андрій
Казакевич, you now have the floor for your version of for your vision of the dialogue.
Да, спасибо.
Yes, thank you.
Ну, в общем, наверное, ситуация все последние два месяца в этом.
Essentially, the situation of the previous two months has not changed significantly, or at least.
Движение вот по вопросам. Диалога
общего. No movement, no progress as to the national all Belarusian dialogue. There's been no progress.
Заявили практически все внешние акторы.
Although every external actor, the European Union talked about that, US talked about that, Russian Federation.
В общем, много кто, да, всегда рассматривали это как один из таких важных.
Third countries and blocks. Suggested this to be one of the key elements to resolve the Belarusian political crisis. There's been no progress in that respect so far. It has been said that the government, Lukashenko, first and foremost, does not wish to engage in such a dialogue. Obviously, he does not understand how this dialogue should be arranged, because in these 2 months, well, if not with Tikhanovskaya, Babarika, who is imprisoned. Maybe he could have played around with traditional opposition parties to try and somehow engage or other civil society organizations, social organizations that have some authority, that are of opposition persuasion. So we have not seen any steps beside the visit to the KGB prison of late. At least there's been a first conflict, no progress made, but there was some first contact. As for the opposition side, well, from their rhetoric, we can also, we also fail to see some signs of a dialogue or readiness. Although, again, if the government had shown some intentions to engage in negotiations, or some intentions at least, just to get together and start talking, start the conversation, these things could have been different. This has not taken place yet, and there's this feeling that I keep having, that I keep getting, that it's not going to happen. Then again, we need to consider what kind of information is circling around various sources. This All Belarusian Council or All Belarusian Session can be picked as a platform by engaging some, by putting some opposition members on board, but I don't think that there will be any sizable number of people. Maybe Mr. Voskresensky, another couple of people, that's it. No representation whatsoever. Very, very limited one at that. So the situation here is quite tricky. I'll agree to the statement that the key issue is the lack of trust, because on the one hand, the opposition has a very hard time trusting Lukashenko, because he broke his promises a number of times, not just internally, not just in the domestic setting, but also externally with entities and parties and countries who are much stronger than him. the European Union, at least two episodes can be referred to Russia. Well, this has been a permanent situation, lack of trust, not trusting each other, not trusting Russia. So with this backdrop, with this hindsight, any promises by Lukashenko are quite suspicious, will be perceived as such. Lukashenko does not trust the opposition either. He does not consider the opposition to be a political entity that can be considered as an equal in a conversation.
We see some asymmetric situations.
The positions are different. The government and the opposition.
Какие-то институты, которые бы выступали
from that, some institutions need to be picked that will be the guarantors of the fact that the agreements reached will be fulfilled. That both sides will held up their sides of the bargain. And there should be some guarantors that will ensure that happening. Ensure that happens. In some countries, church could act as this guarantor. In other countries, courts are autonomous, independent, trustworthy bodies that can act as guarantors that these agreements reached will be implemented. For social institutions, again, not the case in Belarus, not even close. There's nothing autonomous, independent from the state, politically neutral, no such entity in Belarus, let alone those who would have some mechanisms to ensure this guarantee, to ensure these guarantees, to ensure that the agreements are lived up to. International mediation is something that springs to mind, the only thing. It has been already discussed by one of the speakers. And again, I believe that this is the only mechanism that allows
the
implementation, or at least to a certain extent, allows to guarantee the implementation of the agreements. And these entities are much more trustworthy, both they have both intermediaries. Well, that cohort is fairly small. It's very small. These intermediaries should have some features. First of all, they should be influential, some influential authorities, forces. Next, if there is a coalition, that coalition must not be contradictory within itself. OSCE is not going to fit because it's a good platform for facilitation of negotiations, for assistance in negotiations, advisory, consultations, some techniques, but OSCE is too porous to try to enforce the agreements reached.
Вообще теоретически, если не теоретически, а технически на это смотреть, да, то это все-таки должно быть национальное.
It's too loose. Looking at this, it should be nation states, not the blocs. The rational format now would be, for example, Germany and France from the European Union. These countries are at least involved into the discussion on the Belarusian matter. These are big influential countries. So these nation states are a fit from the viewpoint of prerequisites. So they have what it takes to be intermediaries, plus Russia. The tripartite format, the trilateral format, now looks the most appropriate and the most probable to be the intermediary, two intermediaries to resolve the Belarusian situation. Other EU countries, they are either less interested in resolving the Belarusian matter. Italy, yes, although at some point it was considered as one of the potential parties that were consultations held, at least the opposition political forces tried to engage in the dialogue with Italians. Or some small countries, or some countries with issues with the official Minsk, for example, Poland, Lithuania, the United States are not a fit either, because then for Russia this format would not be beneficial. Russia would not subscribe to that.
Повторю, да, основные, I believe, свои тезисы. Во-первых, внутренний диалог.
I will repeat my main statements.
Потому что доверие.
It's difficult to have trust between the countries. There are no countries that can guarantee or enforce the implementation of agreements. So the only option on the table is the negotiations with intermediaries from within, from outside. EU, Russia, EU most likely being represented at this point, France and Germany.
Again,
coming back or referring to their role in the Belarusian matter over the past 2 months. So that would be it in a nutshell. Yes, thank you, Andrei. Yes, I fully agree, fully second your opinion. I'm even recalling some of the statements you've made, this Normandy format for Belarus. You've made the statements in some of the interviews I've read before. So these were the negotiations in the Palace of Independence at some point. So now that they will be necessary for the Belarus itself, for Belarus itself. Yes, just a different name, not the Normandy format. A different name should be picked. No, Normandy is a good association. Normandy Niemann, the joint regiment in the Second World War. It's a good association. Yeah. Rings a good bell. So
Варданяну,
I would like to
говорить про опыт
to Edgar Варданян, to have him contribute on the Armenian experience, because it's clear that the contexts are different, situations are different. Oh, the duration of the conflict or the protests has been different. But again, Edgar Варданян, you have the floor to elaborate on as to what can be applicable, useful from the Armenian experience, some pitfalls which are not that obvious that come up in these dialogues that should be known ahead of the dialogue. Yes, thank you for the invitation to participate, to engage in this discussion. Let me start with this. The Armenian experience is very interesting in that it is practically a successful experience of civil resistance. Over a short span of time, within 1 month, one odd month, this lasted. So there was a series of mass scale campaigns, rallies of civil resistance with all available technologies and tools, let me put it this way, so completely non-violent civil disobedience. This was how it went. It's very important to point out. And essentially, there was no dialogue as such in our case. I mean, the government
capitulated. It
basically surrendered. And it surrendered gradually, incrementally. First, the head of the country resigned, then Prime Minister Serge Sargsyan.
Again,
it's very important to point this out, to highlight this. Through parliamentary elections, there was not the parliamentary election in the sense that
the
parliamentary elections immediately happened. No, they were not run immediately. But the parliament, that was constitutional. The old parliament, the parliament in power. They picked the opposition leader as the head, as the prime minister. They picked, they have elected the leader of this civil disobedience campaign. And several months on, the preterm parliamentary elections were held, the outcome of which was what you know today. The opposition has gained the absolute majority of votes. The old authorities, represented by several parties,
просто-напросто проиграли.
The previous authorities, they simply lost. Lost by landfall. I mean, they didn't even make it to the parliament. The ruling party of Armenia didn't even make it to the parliament. They didn't score over 5% of the votes. They were even unable to do that. The attempts to hold some dialogue, to arrange some dialogue, have been made. At the peak of that civil disobedience campaign, the Marriott Hotel, there was a meeting held, a meeting arranged between Nikol Pashinyan, the leader was better named as facilitator of this civil disobedience campaign. And the head of the state, back then Serkisyan. It was live, journalists around, so there was a meeting between Pashinyan and Serkisyan. They met, they exchanged several words, and then Serkisyan basically left. He said that all of that was unacceptable. The opposition, and specifically Nikol Pashinyan, is simply giving him an ultimatum, and he said that he's not going to engage in the dialogue on these conditions, or in this setting. So he up and left, basically. And then Nikol Pashinyan took his backpack and put it in the chair of Serge Sargsyan, who had left by then, and he said that, I'm just going to run a press conference. You see what just happened. I'm just going to proceed with a press conference because you see that the government is not prepared for the dialogue. So we will go until the very end. We will engage in peaceful protests. But what happened is basically a defeat for the government. So the logic of our civil disobedience campaign was this. The essence was this. The wide-scale protests, they basically drove to the situation that the government that was unprepared to concede, they came to say something, but seeing that everything is very serious, that the negotiations, or how do I put this dialogue, might only have one agenda, one item on the agenda, I mean. What would be the way of transition of power? How will the regime be changed? Time frames and mechanisms, nothing else. Only one item on the agenda. The opposition back then did not want to talk about anything else besides that. So this is indeed the case. This was the language of ultimatum. However, that ultimatum was precipitated by a very serious civil disobedience campaign. So it is often said that protest movements, this and that, is it possible to achieve serious changes, regimes toppled, democracy elected or restored by protests? Is it possible or not? So in this case, one very important aspect needs to be considered. The protests and the civil disobedience campaigns. Yes, it's a civil disobedience. It's a different situation. And Armenia did get to a change of regime through a wide-scale civil disobedience campaign. Civil resistance, civil disobedience is the more appropriate term. Now, the protests are important initially. Early on, they do play a role. However, with protests alone, the Armenian experience goes to show that no serious changes should be expected.
And
it's not just the Armenian experience.
The революции, ненасильственные вот эти смены режима.
The Peaceful revolutions, they show that it's wide-scale civil disobedience that is important, that plays a role. Those that aim at changing the regime, changing the government, changing the power. Only after this protest, only after this wide-scale mass campaigns would the dialogue be possible. All of us understand that authoritarian governments will do everything possible to retain the power. However, the transformation was quite soft, quite mild in our case. If you're keeping track of the events, there are several criminal cases that were initiated against ex-leaders of our country. Well, some of them are still free, lengthy litigation is happening. Essentially, although the language was that of an ultimatum, the essence, and the protesters acted quite tough, but in a non-violent manner. It's a very important point to underscore. All that gave the result, the government resigned peacefully without any serious distress. So this is the main logic of our experience. Several important nuances. Important peculiar features. These actions of civil disobedience campaigns, on the one hand, they were in a kind of a horizontal plane. There was no centralized management of these rallies, of these protests. On the other hand, there was a leader, there was a facilitator, a coordinator, if you will, of that movement, Никол Пашинян, current prime minister. There was also a group of people, mainly this team, primarily this team of Никол Пашинян, that was always there on the front line. And Никол Пашинян was always there on the front line of the protests. Front row seat, front row stand. When the government, when the law enforcement used force against the protesters, first and foremost, these blows were taken in by these activists, by the team, the allies of Никол Пашинян, Никол Пашинян himself. Гражданский договор, the civil treaty, was civil consensus, was civil agreement, was the political party back then, and the mandates were also used. The mandates of the political party were used as a tool. Everything was happening in the streets, naturally.
Исследование Эрики Чановит,
Эрика Чановит, an American political scientist's research about some rule of 3.5%. So she derived this rule when, in percentage proportion, the minority takes to the street and they are actively protesting. 3.5% of the population is enough to take to the streets, and they will bring the change about. They will get change to happen. So I believe this rule did apply in our case. It did work out. The reason I'm saying that is the entire country was in protest. Went protesting, various ways, various manifestations, hundreds of thousands collected or gathered in the square. But those people that were not out in the square actively, they supported this campaign, they supported this rally, the civil disobedience notion in that form or another. And I believe this to be another important point. The overwhelming majority of the population efficiency of the process to make sure that the civil disobedience prevails and the government will be forced, or at least the people can get the government to engage in a dialogue, at least to manifest, or at least to express an intention to engage in a dialogue. Definitely it's necessary for the majority of the population to support this idea, to stand behind this idea of changing the regime. Many things can be said, definitely. Clearly, yes, to get the regime to change, a number of factors needs to come together. Certain multitude of this factor, a certain pattern of this of these factors does play a role, but nobody can say this. Five factors are a must, or 10 factors are a must-have to get success. We can anticipate, we can assume that there are several must-have factors that are indeed must-have. However, we cannot say that there is a certain set of finite set of the factors that would be sufficient to get the regime to change. I've been looking at protest movements in the Eastern Europe of late 80s. It was also quite different in various countries. Country to country, it varied. Polish experience was mostly geared towards dialogue, not like the Czechoslovakian experience. The Czechoslovakian experience, that case is closer to Armenian case, as I believe. A short span of time, a short time frame, serious mobilization, serious civil disobedience campaign, and then at the end, the government simply gave in. They resigned and so on and so forth. So again, this is the old institutions we used to install the new government and the dismantling of these old institutions took place by the new government. So I believe, one more important nuance. It's very important to remember what is the end game. Why are we doing this? Why is this being done? The objective, the ultimate aim, the ultimate goal of the civil disobedience is to install democracy. Changing the government is the task, the goal that needs to be attained. Why do we want that? That's the question. Definitely, it's the prevailing of democracy. Democracy is important not just from the viewpoint of people getting some serious changes within the country. Having a democratic country is important for the global security. It is known, it's a known fact. The democracies or democratic nations do not fight each other.
Azerbaijan.
We see how two authoritarian countries, Azerbaijan and Turkey, engaged into this aggression against the Armenia, Nagorno-Karabakh conflict. It's not just that. It didn't happen in vain. It didn't happen just like that. Just pay attention to the rhetoric of these countries. Yesterday, Aliyev talked about the he said that in Armenia, Soros runs the show, or some abstract Soros, George Soros is referred to. So a very, very similar rhetoric by the Azerbaijani president. And all this brings this about. The leaders of authoritarian countries also go to break or just decide to break the international principles, international law. I put high importance on the civil disobedience from this viewpoint. Successful campaigns of civil disobedience, they facilitate or they can potentially facilitate global security by installing democracy. Well, let me conclude my statement or conclude my points at this stage. Yes, thank you, Edgar. Thank you very much. Indeed, interesting experience. And thank you very much for finding the time in this tough time to talk about something that's different from the Armenian conflict. So we are in solidarity with you. You have mentioned the experience of Poland and the Polish dialogue. Thank you for this wonderful lead-in to the next speaker, Kamil Kwiecinski. I hope you're with us. Yes, I do see that you're around. Kamil, you have the floor now. Let us talk about the Polish experience. At least it's my bird-eye view. Bystander's viewpoint. I remembered
вот сам момент даже диалога прямо круглого стола.
The point, I remember the moment of the round table when everybody was together doing the talking. Historic retrospect, seems like one aspect of the situation was
solved. Длился, в общем, 3 месяца.
I also remember that the round table lasted for 3 months. I mean, the participants of the round table must have thought that it's lasting for the whole eternity. So it would be interesting to listen to the conclusion that you've drawn from that experience, the roundtable experience. Another important point from the Polish experience that might be relevant and interesting, whether the dialogue itself happened correctly, whether what happened next happened correctly. I keep getting this feeling that it's still on the Polish agenda, and it's not just enough to punish the communists that were guilty of all the wrongdoings of the past. Is it the actual practice? Maybe it could be an important topic for the people for decades.
Yes,
thank you very much for the invitation. I would probably start by voicing my opinion as to the events in Belarus very briefly. I would like to give my evaluation of these events. In my analytical line of work, I keep an eye on the things, and I make it an objective of mine to draw conclusions on the matter. It's very difficult to contribute something new and original to what the colleagues have already said just now. I agree to the point about the lack of trust. Lukashenko needs to be put in the police car, the police vehicle, after Zak. He said that only the bandits are out in the streets, and they need to be handled somehow. There is no trust, there is no respect, mutual respect. I see no internal or domestic platform for the dialogue. It's also absurd to regard the meeting at the KGB prison beginning of the dialogue or attempted one. It's a very extraordinary event. I will keep referring to that at a later stage. But if we're discussing the Polish experience, the roundtable in Poland was possible in this situation. It was not behind bars, not the pre-court detention facility, not the KGB prison. Everybody was out.
Three people.
How do you expect a dialogue?
Охранники уйдут в свои удобные квартиры, комнаты.
Say
The
participants of the dialogue, one of them will go to the presidential palace, the prison guards will go to their new comfortable homes, and the prisoners will simply stay behind bars as they were. I saw a very lengthy interview on Tutbai. I don't think that
there
will be a negotiation platform. There were very, very weird things said. So that's it for what I have to say for that lengthy Tutbai interview. I'll agree to Dmitry Gromakov that everything is moving towards confrontation because there are no prerequisites for the dialogues. I would also like to disagree with what Andrei has said about. I will be more skeptical about the third party intermediaries, the international intermediaries. Lukashenko will not have that. Will not approve that at this point. Definitely not. That's how I feel about it. He will not approve having Western intermediaries around the table. Warsaw, Brussels, London. Well, London is no longer the EU technically, but it's still a major Western country. These countries can send their proposals to act as intermediaries, but they will be shot down in a very crude form, in a very rude form, as we saw in August and in September. They will be rejected. International organizations will also be unable to join the scene. I'm also very skeptical about that, although, yes, that could have been a good way to resolve the conflict. That could have been a factor to resolve this.
Россия вошла в качестве
Может,
более реальный посредник Россия.
On the other hand, more likely intermediary Russia is also an interested party.
Потому что Запад заинтересован.
I cannot say that Russia is not interested because the West is. Russia could be interested, but it will not be an intermediary, a pure intermediary in this dialogue. Some time ago, back in August, I expected, like in 1996, some influential politicians from Minsk, from Moscow will go to Minsk and start engaging in negotiations, start running the negotiations, but the situation is different. Lukashenko is much older than that. Is not perceptive to some of the things, to many things, he will not approve
having that.
I believe that the Russians are looking forward to the constitutional reform, not in the format like Lukashenko suggested,
but
in a more profound manner, so that the presidential power, the Lukashenko's power, would be weakened and then leading on potentially to a change of the government. Well, the personality will change, but the democracy will not be installed. So two scenarios in this setting that I can identify. The first course of events is quite adverse, quite negative. We cannot rule it out. It's brutal and violent. Reprisals, oppression against the protesters, but all those interviews by the Ministry of the Interior about rank and file bandits out in the street,
well,
on the one hand, they can only be a psychological bit of pressure, and I would really like to see it remain as such. On the other hand, it could be a preparation or a forward to something more serious. If that happens, well, a spark of hatred might be displayed by the society, and then everything will spin out of control. So the next second scenario, lack of dialogue, confrontation, but without violence in the streets, without violent oppression. Every week there'd be a demonstration, the law enforcement will be more or less withdrawing from violence, refraining from violence, from tough beatings at least. And everybody will look forward to what Lukashenko has to offer, I mean the constitutional reform, in which case the decisive factor will be the word of the street. What will the people in the streets have to say for that? I don't think that there will be much time for the protesters to do that, and the conflict will become extended, it will become protracted. Russia is also party to this conflict, let's not forget that. Everybody will try to strive to some compromise. So no violence, Belarusian non-nomenclature and the Belarusian streets, they will need to be considered. Getting back to the Polish experience bit, as I have said, back in the day, Poland had multiple factors, several factors that precipitated those negotiations. They made them possible. First of all, one party to the negotiations was not in prison. I've mentioned that initially. That's one of the basic factors that my must not be discarded. Both parties realized that this is the end. This was the end. We're all facing the wall, the dead end. The government, the civil society, the Solidarność trade union, it was also in a poor shape in the late 80s after this large spark of the strikes of the industrial workers in the early, mid-80s.
Then this military,
after the martial law was imposed, the Solidarność took to the underground. It was still there, but not as glorious out there as in the early 80s. In the late 80s, they realized that they could not rule the country as they were. The parties, the political parties that are not available in Belarus, that are not present in Belarus, they make the situation different. Back then, there was one big pro-government party, the Communist Party. Belarus does not have a pro-government party. The communists realized that they will not handle the violence themselves. it was visible that the crisis in the USSR was quite profound, but the collapse was not still around. So they knew that they had to do something to try to rescue the country and to try to get to the dialogue stage. Something that had been happening for three months, I would not say it was a bad thing, but there were many professional groups for various items, various issues, various sectors reforms, and this required time. One more important factor of these negotiations, something that is being criticized the most, something that is taking the flag big time. You've mentioned I mentioned this a certain time ago. The Polish politicians are criticizing the outcomes of the round table. The matter of law enforcement. It's an interesting experience for Belarus because at this point Lukashenko is basically running the country with the support of the law enforcement. Yes, there are his allies in smaller cities, smaller towns, and not that many, but still there are people in Minsk. I do not believe in the motto Sasha 3%. Belarusian government has the Yabatska, I'm the father of the nation motto, and the opposition has this Sasha 3%. Very low support figures for the president. So I don't think that these parties will end this tug of war bit soon enough. The round table was a good experience of reaching an agreement with the law enforcement. This is the most important point. This is the most vulnerable thing when the government is, when the country is transitioning from authoritarian rule to at least partial democracy, then the law enforcement must be consulted with to avoid the violence. The law enforcement back in the day realized that thanks to these round table negotiations, they will be able to softly and mildly transition into the Polish new system. They will not be punished en masse because they were at the wrong side of the barricades. I don't think that the Belarusian law enforcement thinks that way. I know that Svetlana Tikhanovskaya made a statement today that please come over to our side, you will not be prosecuted, you will not be punished, but that's not enough. There's no force, there's no conviction. So there's no force on the part of the opposition and there's no conviction on the part of the law enforcement that this is going to come through and that they should fall in line. Something that the biggest success to the roundtable in Poland was the agreement with the law enforcement. The Ministry of the Interior, the Special Forces, General
Czesław Kiszczyn,
they rest in peace. They realized that nothing is a threat to them. They will become the members of the new government, where Tadeusz Mazowiecki became the leader. The agreement with the law enforcement, with the Ministry of the Interior and the Secret Service, this was a good experience. So that's it for my part. Should there be any questions, please feel free to fire.
Спасибо, Камиль.
Yes, thank you, Камиль.
Ну что, мы сегодня многое обсудили, мы сегодня прямо красиво выкладываем.
Actually, we have discussed quite a while. So
комментарии, вопросов.
We have discussed quite a bit right now. We're
Антон, может, у нас есть, если
matching our classical timing, 1 hour of discussions and 1 hour of questions. Are there raised hands, Andrei? May I contribute a comment? Okay, the first raised hand, of course, I cannot see that all the points of my questions to Anton.
Okay, Andrei, you have the floor.
Yes, I will refer to what Camille has said just now to refine my position. He said that he thinks that the intermediary international intermediaries will be impossible. And then he says that there's going to be long-standing resistance and the opposition and the government will need to find a compromise, which the Russians would be happy with. So again, there will be a third party intermediary, an international intermediary. I wanted to talk about purely technically, the resolution of the crisis. could be either by force or by dialogue, right? Two scenarios.
Ну, это другая ситуация. Мы тут просто пока не в пределах этой дискуссии обсуждаем.
Well, it's not within this discussion to debate on that.
Я не вижу, по какому ситуации.
Second option, the dialogue. I cannot see a scenario of that happening, of the dialogue happening, without third party or external mediation.
Россия, Лукашенко.
Although this EU, Russia, Lukashenko, the opposition, whether they want it or not, it's still it's an operational format.
Ну, странно к этому.
It's not there yet, of course. Lukashenko is reluctant to let the Europeans to the negotiation table. Russia is not sure about their position, about their standpoint. So we can run through all these aspects and conclude why they are impossible. But this protracted situation, well, the crisis is becoming protracted. The political crisis that we see, the government is not doing well. The economic crisis is also quite severe. It's also pressing against the nomenclature, the power that be.
Well,
essentially, this might all bring about the conditions where all the parties will feel compelled to talk and agree with each other.
It's just
another statement of mine. I simply cannot fathom technically how these kind of negotiations can happen without international mediation. EU, Russia, Belarus format looks like an appropriate one. It's more viable. How should I put this?
То опять же, это может не решить
кризис. If it's only Russia, this might be short of, this might fall short of resolving the crisis, because the domestic situation, well, there is no absolute trust internally in the country towards Russia, and Europe cannot become such an intermediary in principle. So this is the coalition that I've just mentioned that might bring some result, might bring some progress.
So again,
I'm only hypothesizing institutionally. If somebody can say or can refer to other institutions that can trigger the national dialogue, not just force being used to try to handle the street protests or dialogue, so any other ways to get the dialogue. Okay, to clarify, I said that I'm unfortunately reluctant to believe that the international mediation is the way.
Analysts do not do politics.
I did not give a political manifest. I didn't introduce a platform, a political platform. What I see is that the Western intermediaries, the Western mediators, will not be perceived by the Lukashenko as viable actors. This is a clear standpoint of the Belarusian president. Okay, that's clear. So if we proceed from what Lukashenko wants, well, definitely.
I'm
talking about the situation where Lukashenko will be forced to engage in a dialogue. He's not just going to take to the negotiation table.
Это невозможно. Даже России невозможно, я скажу.
It's impossible. It's even impossible to have Russia as a mediator. So if we ask Lukashenko what he wants,
это подтверждаю. Но я говорю о том, как может быть разрешен кризис, если
this is the case as an analyst. But if the crisis becomes even more protracted, 6 months on, what's the protest movement look like? What would Lukashenko look like? The economy, what is going to be like 6 months on?
So
if the time for dialogue is ripe, and there are countries willing to help the dialogue, so this is the only operational format, working format that I see. I believe that this pseudo roundtable that was mentioned a number of times today, that the KGB prison, detention facility,
so
Lukashenko wanted it optimally when he put this prison, put these people into prison. I don't think that he thought that, okay, let's put them all behind bars and then engage in the dialogue.
So
what he did is not exactly what he wanted to. Four hours in the daytime. It's what he saw necessary. It's not how he wants it. So, okay, so there must be some readiness to dialogue without international pressure. Okay, Andrei, let me elaborate on the external pressure. Is the dialogue possible in the first place? Maybe the structure of the dialogue will be reconsidered. Maybe the countries or actors that we talk about as intermediaries right now, they will become the negotiation parties. I mean, in part, in particular, Russia and the European Union represented European Union provisionally, who will be the beneficiaries at this stage in Belarus. Because the essence of the conflict will be this.
Росіяни і хотіли би, условно говоря, сделать такую мирную анексію Білорусі
в БССР. Annex Belarus peacefully and turn it back into the BSSR. But the West said that if you do that, we will impose sectoral sanctions against Belarus and everybody external that goes to these enterprises or tries to work at these enterprises in Belarus, they will become victims of that sanction policy. So the situation is in a kind of an equilibrium where the Russians are afraid to use their tools of influence. And the Europeans are being kept at bay by both Russians and Belarusians. So the big question is, how is the dialogue between the West and Russia going to look like about Belarus? The dialogue of the West, of the EU and Russia about Belarus. But because the political weight that Belarus, the Belarusian government has after the August events, all these protests, it simply prevents or precludes Belarus from being a party of such a negotiation. So it's beneficial for Putin, for the West to say, okay, dude, if this Lukashenko guy engages in genocide, and then yes, you try to do something about that or force, you topple him by force, and or you bring him to Rostov in Russia, and you let him settle there, and everything will be fine. We'll support you. This is what the West might say. So the question is higher than Belarus. It's around Belarus, but not not within Belarus, not domestically. The second question, what is the Belarusian society going to do? Is it an entity? If it is, then there is Tikhanovskaya, and there is Nekhta, which is running the street. And does Tikhanovskaya run the street, as it was the case in Armenia, when Pashinyan was on the front line, he was ahead of the column, he was leading the protests, and he was also leading the negotiations. In this case, there is no entity to represent the streets in the negotiations. And that situation, that KGB prison thing, it was the attempt to hybridize the case of 2010. When Lukashenko tried to negotiate with the political prisoners that I will start releasing you, and you will say to your Western curators, you will relay my terms on which I will release you. So this is the, this is a big question, because back then he started releasing them. What about where are they going to go afterwards? That's a big question. And the third matter, Lukashenko picked the strategy that the Russians like a lot. He is picking the most convenient negotiation parties. He is looking for convenient negotiation parties for himself that will either bend down to his will, or they will protract this negotiations period. It will become too lengthy for the protests to die down, and then to handle it that way, and then to sabotage the negotiation process, because not Tikhanovskaya, not Nekhta, with its influence on the street, no one can formulate the negotiations position. Nobody can build the position. Where a situation would be, you need to resign, but not just resign. It's not clear what, as Камиль has said, it's not clear what's going to happen to the law enforcement, to the bureaucracy apparatus. It's not clear how these people should act like, what they should do. There is no message that the street can convey to various audiences that they would otherwise, that they should otherwise be dealing with. The Ukrainian experience, the positive experience of 2004, the successful outcome of the dialogue. Our special service, our special services, took a very simple path. They infiltrated the protest movement. In Ukraine, they gave the signal to the bureaucrats, to the law enforcement, that nothing is going to change overnight. There will not be the throats will not be slit, they will not be fired at will, sect at will. So there were negotiations between the internal, between the domestic entities, something that's not happening in Belarus. I don't even see the negotiation field for that to happen in Belarus. Some platform around which the dialogue could be built. So the answer, the dialogue on what? As to how you're going to live together, how you're going to live with Lukashenko in power, or how you're going to live without Lukashenko in power. Well, the position is quite clear. New elections. The protest movement dwells on this. New, honest elections. That's pretty much it.
Более глубоко пока, по крайней мере, не ставится, да?
Well, at least there are no deeper issues, no deeper questions raised.
Другие пункты, да.
Other points that I can comment on. Whether the EU and Russia can become negotiators, not the intermediaries. Possibly, but not at this point. I do not see that happening right now. This dialogue of Brussels, Washington, Moscow, that must be there in Belarus, on Belarus. Well, nobody is admitting to that. Nobody of these guys is admitting to that. So they say that there should be dialogue, there should be common approach to the Belarusian diet, the Belarusian situation. So if Belarusian crisis becomes even more protracted, if Belarus becomes a failed state, well, yes, the Western factors might be growing in importance. But so far, it's only a potential possibility. Coordination between the crowds in the street and the political entities. Well, this coordination is not that. Well, I cannot really say that.
Or
the opposition leaders such as Tikhanovskaya, they do not run the protests, or they do not influence that, or they do not coordinate some mutual agenda. So there is some complex model in there, some sophisticated model of coordination, but it's definitely there.
Есть замеры по поводу
So there are some polls done for the popularity of various leaders in the protest movement.
Или в их повестке там, да,
the polls to show the support for their platforms, the manifests. These personalities, Tikhanovskaya, Babarika, they still have a weight, they still have a certain influence. According to those polls.
So then again,
the situation is much more complicated than putting it like this. There is a standalone protest movement, there are standalone leaders, ex-presidential candidates. Same thing can be said about the works with the target group, the work with the target groups. There are some platforms, there are some programs geared towards the officials, the civil servants, to try to motivate them to switch to the protest side. There are various programs for the athletes, for the workers, for the law enforcement. There are attempts to get that done, to try to work with the target groups, to try and guarantee them safety or some bonuses. Should they be withdrawn from the government. This work is in progress. Yes, okay, Andrei, but you still realize that this work is at the personal level. These are specific people who have decided to resign
for some reason.
These are not the leaders of some groups or clans that were established. They must be established from within.
Well,
there are rumors that this is already being done at this level, but publicly this is not being done.
По выше уровню, но система пока до этого
не. The law enforcement, the top brass, the system is not that in deeper crisis to get that to make that possible. I believe that the bureaucrats or the law enforcement might be thinking about that seriously. Until the point of a specific decision, they should be keeping silent about it. They should stay silent about it. That's exactly the point. If I may, if I can elaborate.
Кратко, потом до Юрия.
Хорошо. Очень кратко. Пример Павла Латушки, его судьба, я думаю.
Павел Латушка, his destiny is what happened to him is a sort of a lesson. Luckily, he's a free person, but not in Belarus. And he's trying to maintain his position outside the country.
Что пока это не привлекает его судьба других.
So far, his what happened to him is not too great a prospect for civil servants. Poland is not doing bad. His living standards and his work environment should be in Belarus. The proper living standards, proper situation, proper work in Belarus.
Мы должны, и я думаю, что Польша всегда так и делала, и
надеюсь,
не только Польша, возможно, с другими партнерами, но всегда включительно с
Беларусью. Trying to reinforce the country's position. Poland will not talk about Belarus.
Мне кажется, кейс Павел Латушко такой кейс.
The case of Павел Латушко is a case for everyone. Well, it's difficult to imagine what the protest leaders could have done for some official at the level of Pavel Latushka. Everyone, considering what happened to him, everything that could have been done for him has been done. And I believe that he was well received in Poland.
Я буквально пару слов хотел, во-первых,
just a couple of words from my side. I would like to think, I would like to thank Дмитрий Громаков for a very accurate observation. He hit the nail on the hand, on the head, as to who's running the streets in Belarus. Indeed, there is Тихановская, Бабарика Тихановский, the husband, the coordination council, and the street is listening.
Помните,
to Nechta,
когда назначили,
listening what Nechta said. You remember when Karanik was appointed the new head of Grodno executive committee? He was meeting the workers, and he said, who are we supposed to talk to Nechta? Because there is the understanding on the government side.
И группа тех, кто реально руководит протестом, это разные.
Actual protest leaders. These are different entities from their viewpoint.
And in this respect, как бы путь,
I don't know. Маленький. Maybe there is a way. There is a small step, half a step that can be taken to institutionalize Nechta.
Потому что если он есть,
institutionalize it. Because if Nechta is indeed running the show, running the streets, it must have a certain status. No, it's not running the show. It's not running the streets. Well, why would you talking about that?
Я просто сказал, это
исследование. It's just a statement. Let's make it a research objective. Дмитрий has worded this very accurately, Дмитрий Громаков. I'm not saying that he gave an answer to the question. He simply raised that question. He's relating to his
experience. И в Армении такого не было. А у нас, кстати, было не первый раз.
It's not the case in Armenia. In Belarus, it's not the first time it's happening. In 2011, during the silent protest in Poland, Хавадянов was also doing this like this.
Кто-то скажет, на самом деле...
If somebody says that,
и так, что просто...
This and these guys are running the show. Well, tell it to me and...
Андрей,
a small clarification point for you, Yuri, because you're going to be answering. Managing the street or running the street has a problem, which is this, what the Armenian colleague has said. Edgar, if Tikhanovskaya was managing the street, was running the street protests.
Своего мужа, Бабарика, и этих самых там заблокировать там тюрьму, на которой они бы подали сигнал готовы продолжать.
They would give the signal, show some kind of preparedness to work until the victory is reached. In their case, it's not seen.
И не видят усилий со стороны лидеров
протеста. They see no effort, and they hear no effort, no preparedness of the protest leaders to victory. They understand that there is some bargaining behind the backs. Lukashenko is trying to strike a bargain with the EU, with Russia.
Протестов как субъектов политических процессов.
So they're not considering the leaders as political entities.
От комментариев.
Okay, Андрей. Андрей, a brief comment. Please, mute your microphones, everyone who's trying to.
І після тоді...
It's really causing serious intervention.
Хто там що руководить? Ну, давайте все-таки...
Okay, as to who's running what, let's consider the structure. What kind of information is Нехта feeding?
And whose
political agenda is it broadcasting? I mean, there was an ultimatum. And what kind of information Нехта is spreading? If you think that he's coming up with it himself, well, what can I say about that? Not much. Let's not permit
let's not
paint too cool the picture of what's happening in Belarus. There are local chats, there are local communities, there's local activity. There are some things that people say, but it doesn't work out, that somebody says, but people don't want that. Other things work out, quite different ones. So Нехта is not the leader, not the manager, it's just a communication channel, which is used by other political entities, political forces, and they're visible. Only if we were to attentively, carefully scrutinize, analyze the information that is fed through this channel. That's my comment, that's it. Okay, thank you, Andrei. The next person to take the floor would be Marek Beckerman.
Здравствуйте, я хотел, простите ли мне, возможно, соединить очень интересных комментариев Камиля и Дмитрий. Камиль сказал, что это силовики. Я думаю,
Камиль said that the law enforcement are the go-to people for the negotiation. It's a very correct conclusion, as I believe. I wanted to merge that comment with Dmitry's question. The concerns of Belarusians that there might be sanctions against Belarus enterprises is the same. Because the law enforcement already own the majority of these enterprises. And there should be a guarantee.
Ограничены ли, мнейшие ограничения революции и перемен.
After a more or less limited revolution, the changes, the law enforcement must be assured, must rest assured that they will not lose their money or their influence.
So if this principle kicks in, 100 dead bodies in the street,
that was true for Romania, to, again, so that Securidad's influence could kick in. To a certain extent, it happened in Ukraine, in 2010 in Kyrgyzstan. Again, if we see the dynamics of spontaneous protests to seize of power in Kyrgyzstan, 2 weeks only, no dead bodies in the street. But if there were to be dead bodies in the street, then the forces who were behind this coup d'etat, they would have done that. They would have had corpses in the street.
І ролі Росії і
we should not exaggerate the role of Russia and the potential role of the European Union in this.
І здесь більше внутрішні фактори грають.
I believe that in domestic factors, the internal factors have a bigger play than the external ones. I agree with Camille. Belarus should be treated as a subject, not as an object. It's a very important point.
Филипп
Беканов. Thank you, Marek. Филипп Беканов.
Филипп, привет,
слышишь? Филипп, hello, can you hear me? Yeah, I was just muted by the host.
Очень большая
память. Very serious interference in there. It's virtually impossible. Yeah, just bear with me. Let me just switch my microphone. Yes, I beg your pardon. Is it better now? Much better. Okay, great.
Тогда, наверное, без камеры. Попробуй просто телефон
кухни. So let me disable my camera. Yes, now it's interference free. Please feel free. Go ahead. Right, the story is who's running the protest. I will join. Yes, Филипп Беканов, the social scientist. He already posted that comment. No. Ah, right. I thought that you're admitted to running the protest. No, I was just referring to Andrei's words. The role of Нехта in this should not be exaggerated, and the entity of the street, who that entity representing the street might be. Let's talk about that. Obviously, Нехта is not the organizer of the protests. If Нехта posts some stupid stuff online, when there was a situation when the march was directed through Orlovska and only part of people went there, people on Sundays will go out and will take to the streets regardless of what Нехта says. If Нехта says that let's skip this Sunday, let's take a break. Well, maybe some portion of the protesters will listen to that, but I'm sure that people will still take to the streets regardless of that comment. So that is a sort of a reference point that everybody through consensus decided to hold it as the main authority, like the Partizanskaya Avenue today. Okay, let's all go to the Partizanskaya Avenue. If this is disapproved, the reference point status, Nechta will lose that status, the subscribers will leave, the followers will leave. So he's not running anything. He's maybe making the protesters' life easier to give them a meeting point in a more consolidated manner. Okay, the next point is who is to be negotiated with. I believe it's a tragic situation both for the authorities and for the protests, because owing to the actions of the government, all the people, all the forces that could have been considered by the street as, say, voices for their intentions, were voices for their will. Some people during the protest campaign that gained some weight and that represent the Belarus that won't change. Maria Kolesnikova, for example, Svetlana Tikhanovskaya, Viktor Babaryka. These people are either imprisoned or forced out of the country. So, accordingly, those people who continue, like Maxim Magrinsov, he's less well known. I mean, if you ask around protesters, do you know this guy? Well, quite a few people will not know who that is. Quite few people will respond positively. Yes, they do know who it is. On the other hand, if the government releases Kolesnikova from the prison, and if she, following Camille's suggestion, decides to offer a deal, to put a deal on the table for the law enforcement, like, we will not prosecute you too much for your brutality, for your atrocities. I believe that this will be considered as this. Somebody was detained, that person was detained in the KGB prison, they broke her there, because we're all people, now she's no longer advocating our will, she's no longer voicing our opinion. And the government has driven themselves into this situation. And the other head of the protest is outside the country. It may be a bit
far away
from the reality of the streets. It's a tragic situation for the protest. Whether there is a potential
leader of
the protests, and not just the leader of the protest, but the leader of like Nikol Pashinyan, like the plants and factories stop on that date, and everybody falls in line. So the October the 26th is happening very, very quickly. Yes, it's 1 week from now. Well, it's clear who to listen to. Otherwise, it's very unclear who is to be listened to, how to engage in a dialogue in this situation. May I contribute a comment?
Yes. Про ультиматум, я вот уже
briefly about this ultimatum.
So
there is a text of that ultimatum in a paid subscription on Belopan. There will be some versions released into the open access.
Лично говоря, да, совершенно не верю, что
quite skeptical about the ultimatum. I don't really believe that something's going to happen. It's an attempt to bring back the internal entity, the internal subject, to regain internal entity.
Вот было сказано либо силовое решение,
okay, либо. So there were two scenarios, like solution through force or solution through dialogue. Two scenarios. I believe we need to refine, we need to clarify what that force is going to be like, and what the dialogue is going to be like. We need to be clear on that. What happened in Armenia? Was that a resolution by force? The resolution of the crisis by force or not? Our experience shows that essentially this wide-scale campaign of civil disobedience campaign, non-violent civil disobedience campaign, drove the government to resign. It basically drove them to resign. The leader of the country resigned.
And
the government was essentially driven towards compromise, because the old parliament It was running for some time, although that old parliament did elect, although unwillingly, but they elected Nikol Pashinyan to become the PM. And that's it. That was it. Now, when we're talking about this force scenario, the violence scenario, we should clarify the following. This pressure, pressing of the street, pressure by the street, non-violent pressure, organized pressure, horizontally arranged by the street, sometimes run, managed, sometimes coordinated. Is it a solution by force or not? I believe that the experience of many civil disobedience campaigns, the experience of many revolutions, non-violent ones, non-violent revolutions, goes to show that protests as such do not resolve anything. Protests per se. People get the regimes to change precisely through that organized, wide-scale campaign of civil disobedience. When the government practically realizes that they are no longer in control, they are unable to run the country. They are not, their decisions are not obeyed. Plants and factories stop, streets are blocked. Essentially, the law enforcement cannot do anything efficient. They no longer want to exercise force because it's no longer efficient. So it's either that or that. So this is what happened in Armenia. Several times the law enforcement went violent. Yes, although we said that this is a violent revolution, this is a non-violent revolution, still during these campaigns, several times the law enforcement did use both the flashbangs, they used batons, and so on and so forth. But there was no violent response. I mean, people went in with their bare hands. They simply disobeyed. They were requested to vacate the street. They said, no, we're going to stay. We're not going anywhere. We're going to stay right here. So they were driven into some other location. Or they were put behind bars into the pre-court detention facility. So they were then released, and then again they self-organized further movement. Nikol Pashinyan, on the one hand, was the coordinator, but it's not like he was completely in control, completely organizing everything. There was a fair bit of self-organization. People got together through Facebook, through other social media, messengers. They simply employed their circle of contacts. It's very developed in our case, in our country. It's horizontal contacts, friendships, friendship relatives. All of that was used. In any event, what I can say, pressure today can be either by force or non-violent. It could be violent or non-violent. Okay, if we're talking about a civil disobedience campaign, it must be organized. It's impossible for the people to just take to the streets and get something. They can get out into the streets to protest against something they're not happy about. But to get that protest to attain some goal, to attain some more serious goal, for the protest to become something more threatening to the government, that the government might lose its power, so that the government would fear losing the power, that the government would take them seriously. They cannot simply discard the people in the street. They cannot simply manipulate the media. Of course, yes, these measures will be tried, but they will not be effective. The people will not be influenced by these tools. So that takes a certain extent of certain amount of institutionalization, not necessarily into some formal coordination council and so on and so forth. But it's fairly obvious that at least a certain group that has some informal status, and that group enjoys authority among the overwhelming part, of the, among the vast majority of the population, among the protesters. So if we consider the matter in this, from this angle, I believe that the discussion will be of a different nature. So today we're circling around the point whether the dialogue can indeed happen. But the dialogue, for the best part, if the population has the goal to change the regime, if the government, if the people want a democratic government, the dialogue is just an end. It's an end game. It's the final bit of this wide-scale protest movement. So either the governments, finally realize that they lose control over everything, and they start engaging into dialogue. First, they say, okay, let's talk. Let's talk as to how your requirements are going to be implemented into real life. Or the government simply loses this time. The government loses this time that could have been used for the dialogue, and they simply resign. Or at the very end, to negotiate over some less important details, as to, okay, so the government resigns now, who's going to be running the country? In what way? So when are the elections going to take place? So we need to understand the following. In any event, if the dialogue takes place, does take place, an actual dialogue, a real dialogue, that means that the street has won, that way or another. Has the street won in Belarus today? I don't know that. In what way are the Belarusian people protesting, I don't know, people wishing democratic radical changes, longing for that, how do they see the regime changing? How do they see their actions to get there? So I believe the impression is this. The people are, if we take a bystander view on our discussion, so it looks like we're already discussing the final stage. The people have gotten their way, and we're talking about how this dialogue is going to take place. The Polish example, by the way, the round table, the 3 months it had taken. So the street did prevail back then. When the communist government engaged in the dialogue, it wasn't just they decided, okay, what do you guys want? You want change? Okay, let's try and talk about that. No, it wasn't like that. The government realized that if they do not engage in the dialogue, it's only going to turn to the worse. The situation is only going to turn to the worse. Quite a number of documents has been declassified, vast amounts, the reports of the Ministry of the Interior, Internal Affairs, the Ministry of the Interior, reports. So it's quite obvious, it's quite certain that the Polish government believed they'll be able to share the government, to share the power, not release it completely. They were not prepared to, okay, we leave, and then the democratic nation modeled after the West will be installed. No, the communist government hoped that after this roundtable, or as an outcome of that roundtable, they'll be able to maintain some ground. They'll be able to keep some ground. However, the democratic opposition will also be a part of that. And possibly later on, we will trick them. Yes, this was the mindset back then. The communist government thought that. And we're going back, we're going to go to business as usual. This did not happen. The communists lost, like by landslide in the elections. So they were not prepared to that. They did not see that huge loss, that serious a defeat. Otherwise, they would not have the round table. They would not have allowed that. The streets has prevailed in this way. They forced the government to engage in a dialogue. On the other hand, the communist government thought that by this compromise, by this limited compromise, this roundtable, they will be able to maintain some ground. They will be able to maintain some power.
Действительно необходимо вот для того, чтобы дискуссия была более результативной, вот говорить о том.
I believe that for the discussion to be more successful, we need to be more clear as to what we believe by the fourth scenario, the dialogue scenario. And we should not forget that the dialogue comes somewhere at the end.
And
the dialogue means victory already. It's at least a partial victory by the street. Okay, thank you. I also wanted to identify something. Yes, we are talking.
Как-то иначе выйдет, то есть я понимаю, если мы говорим про силовое решение, но это, грубо говоря, такое...
Yeah, there is a solution, but...
Это силовое решение вопроса.
More or less this people in prison. This is the fourth scenario.
Собственно, почему сейчас... Почему не силовое решение вопроса? При том, что...
So there's quite a lot of automatic rifles and tanks that the government has. Why do they not resort to that? Because they believe it's only going to make the waters worse. It's not that they feel sorry for the people, not the case. They only believe that they're going to make their situation worse. Another opinion. So this defended us against bad going to worse. And without dialogue, it's only going to get worse. So we'll need to wait for the next stage. Andrei, yes, I would like to elaborate that besides the Tiananmen Square, there is the Ukraine of 2014 scenario. The fourth scenario, in my perspective, is when one force comes and topples the or removes the other, maybe without violence, but without the dialogue, without the compromise, without the discussion of the rules of the game. That's what I refer to as a fourth scenario. One power replaces the other, removes the other.
Okay,
if I may, I could contribute to this fourth scenario. I also thought about something like Tiananmen, although I'm not a big advocate of these scenarios. China and Belarus are very different. Ukraine and Belarus are very different. Significantly different. One from another, and they should not be like extrapolated. So one situation should not be extrapolated 100% upon the other. The Belarusian revolution, as I refer to it, is quite different from what happened in Ukraine. What had happened in Ukraine, because if we're talking about even the barricades that ended quite quickly in Belarus, it was quite spontaneous from early on. It was not organized. They were removed quite quickly. There were no big barricades in the Belarusian case. For the Polish scenario, let me reiterate. Everybody was convinced back then. The opposition, the government, the communist government were convinced that they were tired of all that. They will not be able to live on effectively. So the government will not be able to be an effective government, and the opposition will not be an effective opposition. So they decided it would be best for the country to negotiate, because the country was unlivable. It was inefficient at the time. They realized that. Let me also underscore another important bit. Now, if we're drawing parallels, although it's there should not be a one-for-one comparison, no 100% extrapolation. If the Polish scenario of 1989, precisely, that round table, when it completed. And something that could take place now in Belarus. The most important bit was the back then ally of Poland, the USSR, It was slowly, but then it slowly started disintegrating, and then it was rapid disintegration that followed. That Russia is in the crisis like the USSR back then. I wouldn't say that Russia is in that bad a shape. They do have their own problems, profound problems of that, and their problems will come to show at a later stage. But we cannot compare the USSR back then and Russia now.
And Лукашенко
is supported by the influential, powerful Russia.
Да, сейчас, Дмитрий, кратко уточню, что когда я говорил про Тяньаньмэнь...
When I was talking about Tiananmen, I was not trying to compare, because it's different realities, of course.
Утопить протест в крови, или для того, чтобы...
Not to say about... Well, Tiananmen was the metaphor for a bloodbath protest. No, nobody wants that. Of course, it's just a metaphor, where we can visualize what happened back in the Tiananmen revolt. So I just use it for brevity. Дмитрий. Right. As to the force scenario,
на примере Армении могу сказать, что это был силовой сценарий.
I can say on example of Armenia, their protest was a forceful one. There was an attempt by the government to suppress it by force, and later on they did not reach the dialogue. They got the negotiations about how one of the parties capitulates. So, surrenders. For Armenia, it was a forced scenario, from my viewpoint. The non-violent or non-forceful examples that we've discussed is the Orange Revolution of 2004 in Ukraine, because indeed there was no violence used, there was no force used.
And пошел на диалог изначально.
Back then, governments engaged into dialogue, and they made some concessions to not become a leader, to not become the negotiator from the street. They were the intermediary between the two forces that were contenders for power, and there was a compromise reached. So this is how Ukraine 2004 resolved the crisis, attempted to resolve the crisis through a dialogue successfully. As for the Belarusian scenarios, we do not regard the personal factor of Lukashenko, which had merged with the state, which believes himself to be the state. In this case, Lukashenko does not strive for dialogue, nor does he strive for compromise. He's fighting for power. The street is fighting for the democracy. There's different things. Lukashenko has no compromise in fighting for power. Any compromise with the street, as Lukashenko perceives, it would be losing a share of power, losing control over the country. He realizes that when some agreement is reached, something that happened in Poland is going to take place in Belarus, or something that took place in Ukraine is going to happen in Belarus. When the losing parties
на следующем этапе несли уже политическое поражение.
They were defeated politically at the third stage, which was that fatal blow to them,
не оставалось возможности вернуться.
Basically precluded them from ever coming back.
Для Лукашенко очень важно.
I believe that it's very important for Lukashenko in this Belarusian crisis. Not even for Lukashenko. I mean, it's important for us to understand about the current Belarusian crisis that Lukashenko is more likely to follow the Gaddafi scenario, something that, or the Romanian scenario, something close to that. But it's unlikely it's going to be like in Ukraine, because Lukashenko does not have the infrastructure to arrange that sort of a dialogue. He'll only try to play that card that I've mentioned. He will try to find the negotiators convenient for himself. So this progress, this movement towards dialogue is only possible through the radicalization of protests. Why the government does not want Tiananmen in Belarus? Because they realize the ratio of the forces and means the protesters have and the government has. Into their favor, it's not clear whose. So,
там из действия как-то выхватывая, да?
Trying to
они тем самым...
So they're trying to get the protests into a safe zone. The government wants to take the protests to a safe zone. If you want to take to the street, well, please, don't block the streets, don't throw benches at each other, don't burn cars. That's all the conditions. So for that to be implemented, the government has enough force. The radicalization that we see over the past several rallies.
Я считаю, она связана не столько с радикализацией самого общества и самого.
It is related not to the radicalization of the society or the protest movement itself. It's because the number of the people.
Протестанта.
The number of peaceful protesters is going down.
Которые участвуют в протесте.
There are more people oriented to.
Увеличение
радикальных. Participating in the protests. So this is why we see more radical action. If previously the peaceful crowd could suppress those violent guys, well, now there's simply nobody around, not enough people around to suppress that violent action. So something that the Belarusian law enforcement said, so these elements should be taken out of play.
Каких-то материальных, да,
so unless the protest is materialized somehow, or is becomes tangible somehow, brings tangible victories, then most likely in 3 or 4 months it will be suppressed. Same way it was suppressed
недармоедов, да?
By the march of the parasite, social parasites in 2000.
Подавлен, но по сути он где-то там
was a briefer protest, but yes. Otherwise the protest died down and it went from external to internal agendas, trying to manifest during the next election cycle. Okay, thank you, Dmitry. No questions in the chat box. Are there any people? Yes, I would like to throw in a small comment. Edgar?
Right,
so if we're saying that the Armenian experience is the solution by force,
protestующие,
or is the force scenario? We should say this, the protesters, the people that were part of that civil disobedience campaign, they did not resort to force. They did not even respond by violence, to violence of the law enforcement. They did not respond to force by force.
Силовые структуры, они применяли силу.
When indeed the law enforcement did use violence. And the protesters simply did nothing. They did not obey. That's, of course, certain pressure, but this is not physical force.
This
is pressure that the streets put, but they physically did not touch anything by hands, literally.
Вход и кулаки даже не пускали.
They did not even use their fists.
Не было никаких там покрышек.
Let alone tires burned, let alone Molotov cocktails, nothing like that. Nothing like that was seen in Armenia. But indeed, yes, the government did use, the law enforcement did use force. So this term, force scenario or forceful resolution, it is not, it is a bit too vague. It is a bit too vague. Let's not confuse force and aggression. Force
духа.
Yes, it could be the force of spirit, force of civil responsibility, civil activity. We're not talking about aggression. Yes, force and aggression. That's very important to segregate these. So the Armenian protest was non-aggressive, indeed, but essentially.
Даже не на компромисс, потому что
the government back then didn't even compromise. I mean, the agenda was still the future of the country. There was some responsibility that the government assumed and resigned. There was some understanding that they also should secure their own future. For Lukashenko, who's been running the show for 26 years on one and the same spot, he merged with the country. Yes, yes, we heard that point. Thank you.
I believe
that we did a very, very appropriate terminological segregation. I mean, force and aggression. Force could be violence, be that weapons used or, say, tires and tire irons on the part of the protesters. And the other thing, force is when you simply force your decision through. You push it through because you want it in any country out there. We had
a question
from iPhone. He wants a small comment. It's Andrei Lavrukin. Okay, Andrei, clarification. Andrei Lavrukin. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Good evening. Can you hear me well? Yes, yes, we can. Okay, I wanted to say this. It seemed to me that our Armenian colleague and our Ukrainian colleague, it seemed to me that they have quite reasonably described the status and nature of these negotiations that are sort of not related to a very important circumstance.
The way
I see it, the protest simply did not gain enough negotiation weight that could be enough to deem it as an entity to the negotiations, as a party to the negotiations table to be perceived by Lukashenko. I believe that the protest was living its own life, a bit slowing down initially. Back in August, when the factories, the plants joined the protests, back then it seemed that finally the protest had gained that momentum, had gained that force and weight to put it behind the negotiations table. But it was not part of the conversation. Nobody representing, only the Minsk tractor plant was represented in the Coordination Council. Later on, yes, but not then. At that time, the Coordination Council took that position as if they are hovering over the struggle, as if they are the third party. And I believe that this is when they simply fell out of the process. Now the situation is very different. Now the Coordination Council puts this negotiations model on the table as if today the situation is like it used to be. As if the situation is, as if the Coordination Council represents the street in some form, but this is not the case, as the colleagues have said. And in this regard, I would like to say, we'll try to draw a line to make to draw a conclusion here. The decisive factor or the decisive test, the ultimate test, whether it's possible to even talk about the negotiations, whether it's even possible to say that the protest movement can become an entity and gain that political, gain that negotiation weight to a certain extent, we're not talking about the exact extent, to have Lukashenko accept the protest as something meaningful, as something with weight. We will have the question answered on October the 26th, when it finally becomes clear whether there is some force behind that, whether there is some force behind this purely declared, at this point declared, pretense for a strike. Well, if there is a if there is a strike, there is a political sense, economic sense of the word, if that ambition is reached, then possibly the round table, the dialogue could be revisited. That idea could be revisited. But at this point, I completely agree with the colleagues there.
Несколько оторванный от конкретных.
These things are a bit out of touch with specific from specific agendas, from specific constellation of notions, roundtable negotiations. It's more of a rhetorical figure that Lukashenko uses himself to try to sweet talk, to sugarcoat, to try to have a meaningful, to try to have a manageable negotiation conversation on the negotiations. I kept having that impression when Lukashenko came to the KGB prison, talking about compromise. All of this looks like this a bit of an attempt. So it's either Lukashenko or the pro-government experts talk about that.
We
even see in the mottos, in the slogans, the pro-government pensioners, retired senior citizens, they are talking about the unified, united Belarus, or the united country. Still centralized, still managed by the same authority, the same government, this manageable unity. This is what they mean by the united Belarus. So this bit is very important. This is a moment of truth.
Protest
will become an entity, or it follows the scenario that the Ukrainian colleague comparison with the social parasites, with the Tuniyatsi protest. It's a very adequate assessment of the situation. Yes, there will be some time for the comments, but since we're running, since the time is running short, I would like to voice the question that was typed into the chat box. So this is the question. Possibly you could offer some, suggest some things that rank and file people protesting in Belarus right now could do against lack of, against violence and against... Primarily, Andrei and other participants from different countries, what could they say about violence, about lawlessness, about what can be influenced on by the Belarusians right now? What steps would be most efficient, as the experience of the countries represented here shows? So Andrei, comments from other. Well, I will not decide. I will not advise you on anything. There are specialized channels that list all these actions. Some things work, some things don't. About October the 26th, this is not going to be the Rubicon. This is not going to be something like that. It's a lengthy process. It could take months. Could take more than that. I would not wait for October the 26th, like something will be demonstrated, something will be displayed. Well, most likely there will be a spark. Well, a surge. We will live to see. With a big likelihood, it's only just going to be yet another stage of the protests. About the protests dying down or not. Well, we cannot say that. We can't say that. Although these past 2 months have shown quite serious analytical work, polling of the activists was done, surveys, at least the figures are known. It doesn't seem spontaneous, it doesn't seem unstructured, doesn't seem unlinked, uncontrolled by the leaders. There are no grounds to say that.
Видеть, да, это они просто так вот там, смотря на некто, думать, что...
Well, it works. It's not just people looking at некто can say that, well, some specific guys concocted this. Well, without making the things long, let me make a comparison. This protest has been around for more or less for 6 months, when there was a mass political mobilization of the population. There were only two other examples in the history of our country. There was the political mobilization of 1996-1999. It didn't last for a month or even a year. And the next is 1991. It was a lengthy process. I believe that these comparisons are more valid than saying that people are simply gonna go home in two months from now. And it's a purely analytical model that I'm suggesting here. We'll live to see what the actual life is going to look like. Okay, going back to the surveys and the polls, you're referring to Oksana Shelis' work, analytical work. That included, yes, that included, although not just that. Can I look at those pieces of research? Yes, we will talk about that if you want a bit later. Okay, thanks, Andrei.
Камиль,
Эдгар, Дмитрий, whoever is prepared. Okay, maybe briefly from my side. Well, Poland is very close to being accused to try to stage an armed invasion of Belarus. So I will refrain from advice of what to do, what kind of peaceful protests should look like, what people should do. Let me voice a comment, like a concluding statement from my side, very briefly about the length and nature of the time frame and the prospects of these protests. All of us keep talking about the dialogue. We're talking about the prospects and nature of the dialogue. What about the protests? Are they really going to die down? They can, because of those threats that are, firearms, actions, the weather, all of that might contribute to suppress the protests. However, it's all temporary. I would disagree with Dmitry here. It's difficult to compare what's happening now with the social parasites, the Tunyatsi protests from a couple years from now, several years before. I hate pathetic statements, I hate pathos, but again, the subjects are turning into citizens as we're looking at them. So I've been following this since spring, and then, of course, since the 9th of August. Incredible things are happening in the Belarusian society. And trying to suppress that with police batons, trying to sweep it under the rug, well, it's going to be very difficult. Trying to get people to hide in the kitchens and try to get them to discuss the political life of the country over a bottle of vodka, it's not going to happen. The stage of the Tunyatsi protests, the social parasite movement protests, is over. It would be very difficult to rule society at this stage, that has reached this stage. Okay, I will elaborate then about specific points. Well, again, third-party advice, trying to interfere with a neighboring country, trying to stage a bloodbath in a neighboring country. I'm very reluctant to do that. Yes. Well, my piece of advice is very simple. It's important to subjectivize the street.
Майдан породил так называемый.
Ukraine in 2014, there was the spiritual circle of Майдан. Around 25 people that had something to do with the stage.
Лидер группы Океан Эльзы.
Океан Эльзы. Leader Татьяна Черновол,
экспертов, в общем,
artists, basically, performers, experts. It was a circle of independence that could influence the Maidan as a social entity. Actual influencers, key opinion leaders, how do I put this? So I would recommend today to find and to engender some people by the protest, identify and give them weight. They would, the people that would not just be administering the process. So some people are trying to tell me that Нехта is not running the show. Definitely, Нехта is not administrating the process, the protests. Нехта is the communication platform. But essentially, this platform.
Лидерские влияния на этот протест.
Because of the lack of leadership in the protest.
Администратором в том числе.
Нехта ends up being an administrator in part after all. I would support Camille's. And the sound is gone. It's very difficult to say what Dmitry agrees with Camille on.
Посыле, да? О чем он сказал, это далеко не...
So it's not a pathetic statement, it's not pathos, it's not emotional.
Точно так же.
I perceive it
достаточно быстро начнет
like that as well.
И расти в политическом плане, превращаясь
so
в политическую...
The protest will, the Belarusians will
говоря,
incrementally quite quickly turn into a political nation. What this protest is supposed to engender, to generate, is some political process, pro-Belarusian one, without people affiliated with the Russians, with the
артикулировать субъектность.
There should be people who are going to articulate the Belarus as an entity, who will be advocating as an independent Belarus. Edgar, well, I will also refrain from giving advice.
Я вижу, что в Беларуси говорят о том, что.
I see that the Belarusians are already talking about some Armenian scenario prepared in their country. Well, it's a bit of a joke, of course.
Сценариев невозможно готовить.
It's difficult to say. Oh, it's clear that no scenarios can be prepared. It's obvious that all the actual changes of the regime, changes of the government, all the actual real civil disobedience campaigns, they can only take place when there is an actual willingness by the people, on the part of the people of a specific country, to install the democratic government. And they believe that this is possible. And they seek their own way. Definitely resorting to various technologies.
Скажем так, помогают людям.
Employ various technologies that will help people
достигать
efficiently get their way.
Напомню несколько.
Let me just remind you. Let me just give you a few cases about the Armenian.
Это децентрализация.
Several aspects of the Armenian case. First of all, it's decentralization. But on the other hand, it's a certain non-informal
организационная структура, присутствие определенной организации.
Organizational structure. It was still there, the backbone, the informal backbone.
Лидера протеста.
Leader, the legitimate leader of the protests, and so on and so forth.
Второй важный момент это.
The second bit.
Hyperactivity. Гражданского общества.
Hyperactivity of various entities within the civil society.
Неправительственных организаций очень много.
Many NGOs. Quite a number of independent media, various groups.
Вот параллельно действовали.
They practically acted in parallel. They sometimes talked to each other, sometimes they knew each other, but there were people that didn't know. Each other. I mean, there were people unknown, strangers in the street, unknown to each other. They talked to each other, and that was it. They went their own ways, but and they never met again. But this exchange of information took place. There was an exchange of experience.
Создание некой атмосферы солидарности.
And there was a certain atmosphere of solidarity.
Пункт.
Created.
Это
the next important aspect is blocking the streets.
Одного из самых эффективных.
One of the most efficient ways to date. One of the most efficient ways of civil disobedience.
В Армении действительно, конечно, у нас тоже были забастовки.
Armenia had strikes.
Забастовки не имели таких.
However, these strikes. Масштабов. Were not large scale. And I do not believe that they played a key role in Armenia.
Those
limited strikes. They did not cause the campaign to prevail. The key point was blocking the streets in parallel. I mean, people split into groups. They self-organized, they split into groups, and they actually blocked the streets. At the same time, various streets, squares, they did that. 100% zero violence, non-violent struggle philosophy. Nobody used force.
Не применил силу по отношению к силовикам, да,
against the law enforcement people. The law enforcement was using force, we've talked about that. But ultimately, they realized that this is not a yielding effect. And they refrained from further violence later on.
And probably, тоже очень важный момент.
One more important point. Another important point. The protesters, specifically Nikol Pashinyan, They kept making the statement. Everything that's done in Armenia is not about foreign policy. Is not has nothing to do with foreign policy.
Zero.
Nada. Indeed, no foreign governments, foreign entities were involved. That's the case.
And
the protest did not have an external political agenda, foreign policy agenda. I believe that this is important, particularly for ex-USSR territories, countries.
Given
the role of Russia,
сыграть свою роль, ну, какая-то тавтология получилась.
Sorry about this slip of the tongue. Yep, the role of Russia or in the further destiny of these countries, former Soviet Union countries. Russia was not involved in Armenia. Russia was not party to the Armenian protest. It did not back the old government either.
Очень, ну, такими пророссийскими.
The old government in Armenia was believed to be very pro-Russian, quite pro-Russian. There were friendly relations, friendly terms between the Russian elite
and the
Armenian powers that be before Nikol Pashinyan. But Russia did not intervene because they realized that there is no foreign policy agenda of the protest. So this was not a protest against Russia. Something that was happening in Armenia, if the regime does change, Russia should not expect for Armenia to become this hostile entity, hostile subject, hostile to Russia. It will do everything possible to undermine Russia's position in the world, in the region, and so on and so forth.
Но, естественно, тут, конечно же, понятно,
However,
что... Все понимают,
in
что
this
если
case,
страна становится демократической,
everybody realizes that if a country turns democratic,
вот те прежние связи уже не
if
могут.
It turns to democracy, that the previous ties will be severed. The previous ties between the previous elites
Кремлем.
And the Kremlin.
Ну, что поделать? То есть,
well, what is there to be done about it?
Кремлю.
That way or another, Kremlin had to live with it, to make peace with it. On the other hand, Kremlin did see, and they saw the message, a very clear message by the Kremlin, that we're not going to play against you. Armenia said that, basically conveyed that message. This is very important. This is really important. It's difficult for me to say...
Самые разные кейсы, они...
Cite various cases... There might be some common features, but Armenian and Belarusian cases are different. Belarusian case is unique as such. It is unique already. But given that it's also a country, an ex-USSR nation, it's also the OCT, Collective Security, CSTO, Collective Security Treaty Organization, the Eurasian Union, this Armenian experience could be useful for Belarus, or could be somewhat relevant for Belarus. I believe this is all I had to say for this, on this matter. No advice from me, but just citing stating the facts, stating the practical own experience. Let people study it.
Thank you.
Thank you to all the participants of our discussion. So, the intention
to continue,
but we will continue that at our next discussion, hopefully without these long breaks in between, without months in between. I would like to thank our guests from Belarus, from other countries. First, the expert and analytics groups were remote. Now they're going to be also with simultaneous interpretation. So whoever's listening to me in English, well, it's also good news. If you liked what you heard, please stay tuned. Please feel free to become participants and attendees at our further discussions. Thank you very much to everyone. I wish everyone, Armenia, Belarus, may all the problems be resolved peacefully. Whatever those problems might be. Thank you very much until we see each other again.